Joining us now, ladies and gentlemen, is a man who is a Pittsburgh legend, okay? An absolute Pittsburgh legend. He was Batman, late 80s, early 90s. Some people, he is.
Damn right.
Batman. To a lot of people, he is Batman. I think to my parents, he is Batman to a lot of different... Then he went on to the movie Birdman, which was interesting, you know, because of the whole Batman tie. And what he proved in there is this son of a bitch is likable. This son of a bitch is lovable. He's authentic. He's talented, and that's because he is a Yinzer. Ladies and gentlemen, he has a new movie coming out called Goodrich, which is a movie about coming of age at any age, about sons and daughters, mothers and fathers, marriage and divorce, and about realizing what really matters in life is the ones you love. Star of Goodrich, ladies and gentlemen, Michael Key.
Yeah, Michael!
We missed you. We're missing you. It's on us. We're off-centered there. How you doing, pal?
Okay. Good. How are you?
Good. Hey, I've been reading the everything about this movie coming out. Seems like a lot going on, but it feels like you're the perfect human being for said role. The writer of the film actually said when she was writing it, she was doing it for you, and if you didn't do it, she would bury the script, I think, and herself in the backyard if you did not. Did you know that, and also, did it feel like that when you were filming it?
I found that out later. We have a really good relationship. I thought it was a little drastic to bury herself in the backyard, but hey, you know what? If she would have, sometimes you have to do what you have to do for art, you know? So if she'd have buried herself, I'd have felt badly, but you know, somebody had to go down, I guess.
Did you feel like it as you were doing the movie though? It felt perfect for you when you
were. Oh yeah. She and I had a really nice relationship. She's real smart. She's got tremendous style. And she's got genes, you know, her mom, Nancy Myers, and her father was a great writer, great comedy writer. And Nancy Myers is, you know, I would say at this point, maybe legendary in terms of her comedy, you know, and her success and everything like that. Yeah.
So you've been in
I was listening to all you guys earlier because I got to hear you. You know, we had an issue here, I guess, with the Wi-Fi or something. But so I didn't see you, but I was listening to you. You know, I watched the show, and how this started, this whole idea, it was my idea. I said, you know what we should do for this movie is this Pat McAfee show. I said, because
Batman.
I had a whole reason. But anyway, I was listening to you guys talk about the baseball playoffs, which are great, and where you think the fights are going to be. You know, baseball fights, nobody ever really ends up, except for... who's the dude who totally knocked out?
Sean Casey got knocked out, right?
Odor.
Yes. And then that one that slide into second, a Hispanic dude, really good shortstop or somebody, just walked up and boom, like solid shot, just dropped them.
Yeah, Odor knocked out, I think, Tim Anderson at second base. Yes. Yeah, nuts.
But normally those fights are funny. They just are. They're just kind of silly.
Yeah, I agree completely. Let's talk about silly. The Pittsburgh Pirates. I heard you're a Pirates fan. There was an article said, yep, exactly. Let's talk about it. This is my issue with baseball. The reason why I didn't play baseball is because the Pirates.
I was hoping you wouldn't do this.
No, I have to.
I was hoping you. You don't have to.
I have to. I grew up in Pittsburgh. The reason why I didn't play baseball is because the Pirates were so fucking ass. That is why I didn't play for so long during my livelihood. So I wasn't even interested in a sport. I would be.
Yeah. See, that, and that's true. You know, my little 7-year-old grandson, he can, first of all, you can ask, if you ever meet any of my friends, you ask him, he's only 7. We were just watching the Steeler game together. He knows everything. He talks about trades. He talks about draft picks. I mean, his kid's unbelievable. He is a giant Steeler fan. He's a giant Pirate fan. But that's what happens to little kids. They're only human. At some point, you know, your little heart, you believe in everything, you have such hope. At some point, you go, fuck this. You know, and also, what set me off many, many years ago, because I had this thing, I was, you know, everybody came after me, all these old hack sports writers. But I was, years ago, I was walking through Three Rivers, I think, and I was watching these kids, little kids, and their dads, and he had a shirt, and he was, and I started to calculate how much his old man just spent on all that stuff, you know? And I started to get, frankly, pissed off. I started thinking, man, that's insulting. That's insulting. That shows zero respect. But if you don't mind, I could get really, really specific about this. And I love Shelty, and I love the players, and I love the coaches. And I think they're nice people who own the team, but it's a whole fucking conversation.
Agreed. Need to sell the team, man. They sold seven Springs.
No, God. Oh yeah, but stay in the burg.
Yeah.
Oh yes. Definitely stay in the burg. Stay Pittsburgh Pirates. No, Pittsburgh Pirates have to remain in Pittsburgh. But I think what we have been saying, and I'm not a baseball fan, but we have some in the building. Sell the team. You know, like you're going to make a bunch of money off of the selling of the team. They said that this guy's only in it for the money, and you talk about the families, how much money they spend. This is the owner right here. This is the owner.
Nice man.
Nice, great man. I don't know. Yeah,
maybe.
I don't know. I don't know, Michael. I haven't talked to him. But, yeah, he needs to sell the team because baseball is obviously electrifying. We're going to be watching tonight. The Pirates haven't been in there for a long, long time. I appreciate your fandom of them. We have another Pittsburgh question for you from Darius Butler.
Yeah, I do. Surrounded by a bunch of yinzers here. I got to know if you have any – or actually, I know you went here. What was your first experience at the great theme park, Kennywood? I got to hear about this place.
this is a good question. First of all, can you imagine if you think about what Kenny would look like, I know you guys are way younger than I am, but what the insurance would have been like if you think about how most of those rides were built.
Well.
You've seen them.
No, they're good.
Brutal.
Oh, they're good. They're sturdy. They're state-of-the-art. Right?
Duct tape together.
No! They hate Kennywood. All these people talk shit on Kennywood, Michael. All of them. All of these people. No, you didn't know that.
It was great. It was fun. And for a while, they didn't have like the fastest. I think the Jackrabbit was the fastest roller coaster in the world or something. And I remember the thing was we would get my family wouldn't get usually, but a lot of kids you'd buy new tennis shoes, white tennis shoes for the day. You know, you got your tickets from school, and you'd go to the thing. And usually my mom would buy us what was it called, Santa White or something. This stuff used to dip in liquid and it was white, and you would make our shoes white because they were dirty.
Oh, nice, you nice. Know. Got fresh shoes for Kennywood though. All of a sudden.
Oh yeah, man! I knew where nice white, and he'd come home. He'd be totally filthy because you know they got grease and oil and everything on the.
No, Kenny was super clean.
I love you.
Filthy. Sounds like a great place.
I have to talk to you. I think the boys though. We need to talk to you. The fellas there.
Yeah, you got it. Tone Diggs has a question for you.
Let me see them. Let me look at them in person. Say right to their faces, dude. You have to relax.
On Kennywood, you're saying? Yeah.
On the Steelers. You have to chill for a minute.
Michael, I mean, you talked about how you were going to talk about the Pirates and how it's a long story and you get emotional. I do the same with me. I do the same thing for the Steelers, and it's hard. We overreact, and I live in my emotions and stuff like that. But it's hard. But I just want
to... He's the sensitive side of the show.
Yes, I am. And you know what? Listen, you've been in so many great projects. Batman, Birdman, Spotlight, all those. I wanted to let you know, okay? My favorite thing that you've ever done is Need for Speed, okay? De Leon, Toby Marshall, Dino Bambino, Dino Vroom.
Fucking right. Fucking right, Tony.
This show loves Need for Speed. But yes, we are passionate about the Steelers and the Pirates and everything. Do you think that's why?
Me too.
That's why, you know, Manganiello, who else? Billy Gardell, Jeff Goldblum. Billy, do you think, Gardell. Like, there's so many, it's not a big city, but there's a lot of actors that come out of there. Is that, why do you think that is?
I don't know, but more and more too, you know, Zach Quinto, and there's some really, and everybody's so good. I know Billy's a big fan, but I was, since I was a kid, you know, I know I'm much older than you guys. I'm actually teasing you guys, but no. I did think everybody took it too hard. I texted my brother the other night, and, you know, everybody has to relax. I mean, I don't think the kid is playing that bad. I think he's actually playing pretty well. That's a whole other conversation. But listen to this, man. I mean, we could go on. I could do 50 shows of just about that. I couldn't decide which hat to wear today. So it was like I thought, well, they might like the Pens hat. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, no. Hockey season starts tonight. Sidney Crosby back with the boys. Let's go.
He's the best kid. Have you ever had him on? Kid, he's not a kid anymore. Have you had him on?
No, it's been hard to get a hold of Sidney Crosby. He's at the top of the mountain. It's hard to get up to that altitude, I will say.
He's the best. He's the nicest dude. And you know, I remember my first Steeler game. You know, we lived out in Robinson Township, right between McKees Rocks and Coriopolis. Mm-hmm. And I was a massive fan of everything, sports. That's all I wanted to know about. I used to go home and draw after school and draw all these pictures of my favorite players. And my dad somehow came across some, this history is so great, some Steeler tickets. And we had to drive down to, where did we drive to? I forget. Well, we had to get a bus and drive to Pitt Stadium when they used to play in Pitt Stadium. And they were bad. You know, the Steelers in those days were just bad for so long. But that Rooney family is so great. And I distinctly remember how excited I was and what the city of Pittsburgh looked like. You know, as we were kind of country kids, and I was looking out the window. It was so exciting to me. I also vividly remember my first game at Forbes Field. But that Steeler organization is pretty friggin' great, man. I mean, they are
going to win? Are they going to win or not? You're telling them to relax about Justin Fields. Yeah. Justin Fields going to win a Super Bowl? Russell Wilson going to win a Super Bowl? What are we doing?
This year? Not likely.
Oh! Whoa! Oh!
That's probably right.
But honestly, you know, I'm not worried about that combo. I'm not worried about that combo. I'll say now I'm going to get myself into real trouble.
Okay.
Ready? Because I know you guys love this.
Okay.
Why did 2-3 years ago, who doesn't love Ben Roethlisberger? He's a Hall of Famer. He's one of the greatest ever, not just in Pittsburgh, ever. And I was watching the other day on the show. Those old videos of him shaking guys off is crazy.
Man.
I mean, it's unbelievable.
One of a kind.
And then there was nobody like him. And he was great. But let me ask you this.
Okay.
Why years ago were they not looking to draft a quarterback? Because it's going to take a kid 2-3 seasons to get ready anyway. And I know you didn't want to upset Ben, but you got to say, dude, we love you. You're great. But I got a business to run.
So, Michael, that's the whole thing about the Green Bay Packers. They've hit on it a couple times now, you know, and everybody else, a lot of other fans are like, that seemingly works out great. In the moment, though, if you do recall, whenever it all happens, especially for that Green Bay Packers team, they're in the NFC Championship. So you trade up right. The draft for the future as opposed to right now. You got to be able to handle it on the shins. And they don't have an owner up there in Green Bay. They have like a group. So it's not just one owner. One owner has to be able to take it on the shins and be like, we're going to be better in 3 years. It's hard to do, I think. We're a part of the problem. We're like, this is so stupid. And now it's like, this is so genius.
Falcons.
They are fucking geniuses. For it. The Falcons
this year
just did it. Mm-hmm. They took it on the shins. Hard, like very, very hard. It's the right move, though, Michael. I think it is. I genuinely think it is.
Yeah. You know, and it'd have been cool with it if you explained it to him. Mm. I didn't even have to explain it to him.
Oh,
anyway, I guess I should be talking about my movie, or do you want to talk? I'll talk about this stuff all day long if you want.
How is the movie? Movie's great. You feel good to be out there?
Movie's really good. Movie's really good. And the reason I asked him for you guys specifically was guys are going to like this movie more than they think. So, you know, what I think you all should do, all the boys there, should go to a movie with your wives or girlfriends or friends or mates or whatever, your partners, whoever they are. Mm-hmm. Make them take a cell phone. And then when you start to cry, because you're going to cry,
ooh,
I want you to. Yeah, I want to see all you guys crying.
I'm not going.
Because they're going to.
Can't go.
You were just reading it earlier. You're like, I think this is gonna be emotional.
That's why. Yeah. I got sent over a thing. You know, we don't have a lot of yinzers, but celebrities like actors come on the show, so we get real excited for the opportunity and thankful. And I see the way, like, you know, the entertainment interviews go. They always get a preview look at things and they do the whole thing. We didn't get to do that because we don't have enough time to watch the fucking full thing. They sent it over last night, but I wanted to read about it. I wanted to do enough research. As I was reading it to the boys, I was like, boys, this one has a lot of shit to it. This one's got some real this is serious. Multiple families, kids, twins. He becomes a single father, I believe.
Yeah,
in the middle of this whole thing and the way he navigates with his oldest daughter, who's also currently pregnant from the first marriage, and now we got twins. And he's just, this is a real deal, this thing.
Yeah. And you know, it's relevant and real. And this guy kind of has to grow up and quit being not a baby, but self-centered. And it has elements of a movie. And over the years, guys really ended up liking Mr. Mom a lot, and because that little movie was ahead of its time, and it eventually became very, very big and popular. One time I met this guy. He was a young guy in his 20s, I guess. He was a Latino dude, either from Central America or South America, I can't remember which, but he introduced himself to me and said, can I tell you something? I go, sure. And we're talking, and he says, when I was a little kid, my mom sat me down. She was busy. She was working in the house, and you know, she was a single mom, and I was watching TV, and I ran into her, and I was so angry about this movie I was watching. He said, I was so mad at this man. I was watching this movie about a man. He was changing diapers, and he was doing dishes, and he said, it made me so mad. And you know, that's a machismo culture, you know. And he's angry, and she's laughing and laughing her ass off at this little kid. And he turns and he said to me, the movie turned out to be Mr. Mom, and it's now like one of my favorite movies of all time.
Oh, nice! So you're saying this generation's Mr. Mom? You think is how we should pretend?
It has elements of it, but that's, you know, that's about as much as I'll say.
Okay, well, I can't wait to watch. I don't like crying though. Kurt Warner sent me into a movie about his life story. I thought that was going to be like some action-packed football movie. It was a Hallmark movie. I end up crying for Kurt Warner. Now
I had to.
One day, I ran into Kevin Stevens. Remember Kevin Stevens?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Penguin.
Yeah.
And tough dudes. By the way, I'm starting to think hockey players might be the all-around best athletes, either them or soccer players.
All right, let's see if they can throw a ball. But I agree. toughest. I think they're toughest.
For sure.
Doing everything on skates.
Toughest, I think definitely toughest. Very, very athletic. Very, very athletic. Incredibly athletic.
So
can he throw and catch? We need.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
But also, the people we call best athletes, can they skate? I guess we don't really.
Yeah,
that's good. Hey, good conversation.
Double entendre.
My, that's good.
Yeah, I played hockey for a minute, and I was never very good. Anyway, he comes up to me somewhere in Pittsburgh, and he says, "I want to tell you this story." He said, "I go to see this movie I did called My Life." About a guy dealing with cancer, right? He says, my wife was sitting there, it's a matinee, you know, at a game that night or something. And he says, I'm watching this movie. And there was an electrical problem and the projector quit working. And so while they were trying to fix the you know, get things up and running, they turned on the house lights. And he's crying.
Of course.
Tough dude. And he goes, oh, shit. And all of a sudden, people are kind of looking around, and they start to recognize him. And they start to look at him. And, of course, he's going, oh, man, I'm a tough hockey player. I can't have these people see me crying, which I thought was a really funny.
Yeah, that's what you're trying to do to me for this Goodrich movie. Not that I'm a hockey player or tough at all, but I like to laugh, have a good time. But I'll get invested in a story. And anytime you are acting, we know it's going to be good. Do you know how cool you look right now, by the way? This backdrop here.
Awesome.
It looks so cool. You look so cool right now. You should know that.
I have people follow me around and wherever I go and like set me up everywhere.
AJ has a question for you, Michael.
Michael, right. I feel like you have so much range as an actor. I'm thinking, obviously, Multiplicity, unbelievable movie. You're playing four different characters. I heard you may even think about, you know, putting out a sequel to that. That'd be awesome at some point. The Other Guys is another movie where I think you stole the show for sure. But how do you have that range to go from comedy and drama, thrillers, and Batman? Like, not many actors, I feel like, have that kind of range to go back and forth.
You know what, I have to be honest with you. When I started doing this, I'm going to tell you a quick story that you guys will appreciate. I did a play in Pittsburgh, and I used to work across the street at QED, and then I drove a cab in Pittsburgh. I drove an ice cream truck in Pittsburgh. I parked car. I did all kind of stuff, and before I moved out here, and I was doing stand-up for a minute at a little place that nobody even wanted to hear about a stand-up. They wanted to hear music. They hated anybody getting up in front of the microphone and disturbing them. But I was thinking of you guys the other day when I thought about my early things, and I did a thing about newscasters. And I did a thing about Pittsburgh newscasters. I think the bit went something like that, like how they normally speak. And I said, in Pittsburgh, the newscasters say things like this. Two jagoffs held up a Mellon Bank today. So when I started, I was primarily into comedy, but I already done some plays, and I thought my job, I still kind of do think my job was, whatever the gig is, whatever the job is, you have to do, that's what you're supposed to do. So I always saw it as the way I'm fortunate enough to have this career. but it doesn't necessarily work like that at all. But I remember making the decision after I did Night Shift. I did Night Shift, and then I did Mr. Mom. And right after Night Shift, I was offered this role that to me was kind of similar. And they saw what I did, and they wanted to do that guy again. And I thought, you know, if I get stuck, I'm done. I'll get bored with myself, and it's going to end. I'm not going to get the chance to play all these other roles I'd like to play. So I specifically started changing things up early on, and I thought, if it works, it works. If it doesn't, I'll do okay for a few years doing this funny, glib guy. But it didn't interest me. So I purposely went after a couple roles that people wouldn't necessarily see me in, hoping that I could, you know, I get bored real quick.
Oh, yeah, and, me too. Pittsburgh, and, shout out.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. So, yeah. What else? Yeah, I know. We're so short-tempered.
Hey, Michael. Oh, yeah. Amen. And we'll booze a little bit if we have to, and we'll work hard. We'll work hard if we have to. I mean, 100%. There's a lot of Yinzer traits I think that have helped all of us in our respected fields. I assume you feel that way.
No question.
Hey, you talk about that decision to not stay in the same, you know, casting and like. You look back on your career now, started when? In the 80s? And now 2024, you got another movie coming out in October 18th. You feel fulfilled with that? I mean, not a lot of people get to do this for this long and have this staying power. How do you feel about your entire career? You look back on it all.
Proud of that. You know, I look back and, you know, what I passed up, you know. So every once in a while, I kind of go, oof, that one kind of hurt. You know, I could have done that. but usually not, you know, usually not. I just go, no, I know why I didn't. You know, I really wanted to be a dad, and I only had the one, and he you know, it was important for me to not be gone all the time. So I turned down a lot of movies early on because I wanted to have both. You know, I'm an admitted cake and eat it guy too. I won both, you know. So, and I got both for the most part. So, no, but I'm in a tiny percentile right now of guys who continue to do this. You know, I've directed two movies. I'm looking at one now to do again, another down the road. And I'm in a small percentile, but I didn't think I'd be doing it this long. You know, I went through a period where it didn't interest me very much. But now I'm kind of re-energized for whatever reason. I don't really know what the reason is, you know.
Well, hey, we're pumped that you are. We can't wait to watch Goodrich, available October 18th. We're going to go to the theaters.
Yep.
We're going to get popcorn. We're going to get a drink. We're going to go in there, and we're going to watch this magical story by Andy Goodrich, I believe is his name, played by Michael Keaton. And then we're going to cry our eyes out because we feel so good about it.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to laugh. Anyway, I'm a fan of the show, which is obvious, and I enjoy you guys a lot.
We enjoy the shit out of you, too, pal.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks, man.
No problem. Good luck with everything. We appreciate you. Hopefully you see you again. Ladies and gentlemen, legend, icon, Michael Keaton.
Yeah, Michael. Ooh. Ooh.